So with the clinical studies, I've seen a couple with nicotinamide riboside, but I guess the question is with the nicotinamide riboside, there's been a little confusion about whether or not nicotinamide riboside is even really getting converted into NAD inside cells in different organs other than the liver. This was this NAD flux paper that was done by
Rabinowitz?
Rabinowitz, thank you. Yes, that study he recently published just a few months ago, looking at nicotinamide riboside and how orally, at a dose half of what typically is used in all the other nicotinamide riboside animal studies. So typically they do 400 milligrams per kilogram body weight per day. I don't remember how long duration they were doing it, but in the NAD flux study, he did 200 milligrams per kilogram body weight, which is significantly less than what all these other studies, like the one you mentioned with Alzheimer's disease, and other studies that have shown improvements in mitochondrial function in mitochondrial mutator mice and also muscular dystrophy and all that. So,
We use double that dose
yeah,
as
so
well.
maybe this NAD flux study that showed nicotinamide riboside given orally didn't form NAD in muscle, but it did in the liver, could have been a dose-dependent thing.
It would make sense because we've done a lot of this in mice and now in humans, and that there's a threshold that you need to cross. You need to take a certain amount to get over probably the body's clearance mechanisms. And then you get up to a level that plateaus after about 9 days. And they may have just been under that threshold, so the body was just clearing it out. But you have to seemingly overwhelm that clear out system. So that's why we do at least 400 mg per kg
And
in
that's
the
with
mice.
nicotinamide riboside. The question is, I mean, that's like if you talk about a human equivalent dose for like a 180-pound man, that's like over 2 grams a day. And it kind of leads me to my next question, which was the most recent clinical study with nicotinamide riboside, where they actually used a much higher dose than the original study that was done with Basis, the Elysium that had pterostilbene in it. This dose was like 1,000 milligrams a day, and they looked at a variety of endpoints in addition to, I mean, they looked at endurance, looked at,
It was Doug Seale's study, I think.
yes, and there was no statistical significance in anything. It raised NAD levels, but there was no statistical significance. There was trending improvement in the vascular system, and but there was no effect on endurance. And I'm wondering again, well, if we go back to the human equivalent dose, what was given to the animals, that was still less than half. I mean, so the question becomes, is it not even making NAD in the muscle tissue at that dose? Or, which brings me to the nicotinamide mononucleotide. Those studies have been done in animals at a much lower dose than 400 milligrams.
They have. So we in my lab and at the company Metro Biotech, we've been using a whole variety of different molecules and different, we're doing what's called pharmacokinetics. So there's a lot of literature that I could talk for another hour on. One of the big questions people ask me is, have you ever put NR and NMN head to head in a study? And we need to do a lot more of those. Typically, they're not done. And I'm unaware of it being done in humans at this point. But in mice, what we see, and for all the NR folks out there, please don't be angry. This is just data. I don't run the experiments. I just deliver the message that at the same dose, NMN will increase endurance. And I forget what that dose was. It might have been 200 or 250.
200, I think.
NMN didn't increase endurance. Oh, sorry, NR did not increase endurance, but NMN did. We do find that for some parameters, and Matt Kaeberlein, who I mentioned earlier, he works on dog aging now after doing his SIR2 extension lifespan. So Matt also has published that comparing NR and NMN, only NMN work in his disease model, which was a mitochondrial disease where those animals really need a boost of NAD. So one of the issues could be that NMN is a better molecule in that regard. It could be that maybe the mice just work better than humans and we need a bigger dose. But what I'm working on, which is not talked about a lot because it's in the commercial realm, is there's been a team of seven chemists working on much better molecules than any of these two that I'm talking about, super NAD boosters. And we have ones that work far better than NMN. And these are timed release. These are what we call prodrugs. And those are the ones that I'm really excited about for medicines of the future that don't just increase someone's endurance, but could actually treat diabetes and heart disease and cancer and Alzheimer's. That said, we are doing a clinical trial right now with a molecule called MIB626. MIB is just Metro Biotech. And that's a couple of clinical trials that have been done at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. Separate group from me, it's all independent. And that's just a safety study. So when I come back on your show, if I come back on your show, I may be able to tell you if we see some actual efficacy, some results. We're going to be looking in the phase 2 study at strength and endurance in the muscle of people after some NMN dosing. So we're on the verge of knowing if this is real or not for people.